Hello, in this video we're going to try to give you some of our top tips for getting the very best out of your telescope and helping you to enjoy your observations of the night sky. If you're a new telescope user, you really need to learn to love darkness. I think when you first start using your telescope, it's hardly surprising that you probably want to set the instrument up in with as much light as possible. And it's quite common for people to set their instrument up maybe near the kitchen window or something like that where there's a bit of light coming onto it. The sooner you can start making your observations in near to as complete darkness as you can, and certainly freedom from artificial lighting, the quicker you're going to build up your dark adapted vision. And really, the sooner you're going to start to really enjoy the beauty of the night sky. Equip yourself with a torch like this one, a red light torch. Now, one of the things to bear in mind with all these kind of devices, typical ones like this that you'll buy from an astronomy store are probably going to be far too bright. That's no bad thing initially, because remember, if you're trying to see what you're doing, having a little bit more light, this really needs a few layers of brown tape on the front here to dim this down. But of course, you can do it gradually. Avoid trips inside for beverages and to get bits and pieces. Try to think things through, make sure everything's outside ready for you to use it, and really avoid trips indoors, because your night vision, your adapted night vision, could take as much as 40 minutes to get to its absolutely best, and you'll lose it in a fraction of a second if you go back indoors for white light. Gonna have to mention these gadgets, smartphones. They're probably pretty much a boon and a menace in equal measure. Obviously, these are a terrific idea and they're a great way of finding your way in an interactive way around the night sky. But if you're gonna be doing telescopic astronomy and you're hoping to get the best possible views of deep sky targets and you wanna be seeing meteors and all the other stuff you wanna see in the sky, probably a good idea to give this a miss. You can get problems with it quite easily. If all of a sudden someone gives you a call and there goes your night vision, dim it down, get better views. The Swedes have a saying, hurdy-gurdy, orgy-borgy, which roughly translated actually means there's no such thing as bad weather, only the wrong clothes. Make sure you dress well before you go out under the night sky. Setting up your telescope. Pick your site for setting up the instrument with a little bit of care. It will make a difference to what you can see and how you see it. Try to avoid setting up on concrete like this during the day, especially on sunny days. This concrete's going to soak up the heat of the sun and then radiate it at night, and that's going to make a big impact on the quality of the views we get through the telescope. Ideally, we want a south-facing view over grass. It uses that sunlight, turns it into energy, and doesn't radiate it at night, so we end up with a nice neutral heat profile. Try to avoid positioning the telescope that you're looking over houses. Houses aren't as well insulated as they should be in winter, and you often get a lot of heat rising from them. Now, you may feel this next one is insulting your intelligence, but I assure you, hundreds of people get this wrong every day. When you're confronted by a telescope that's got a two-part lens cap or dust cap, do make sure you take off the whole thing and not just a little bit in the center. It's important that you uncover the entire aperture of your instrument. When you've got the telescope set up and everything's ready to go, pull the leg out slightly. Make sure it's very slightly under tension. Do this for all three legs, just pull them out very gently. If you're setting up on grass, it could be worthwhile laying in a couple of half bricks into the soil of the grass to help keep the tripod stabilized, because it's gonna have a tendency to sink into grass otherwise. If you're setting up on decking or something like that, maybe mark the decking with a tin tack or something where the tripod legs goes. This is a good idea so that you put the tripod back out in exactly the same position every time you use it. It will help you to preserve all of your polar alignment settings and things like that, and make the telescope a lot easier to set up and use. Looking at the tripod of the instrument, make sure all of the fastenings are tight. Don't over tighten them. Bear in mind these things aren't designed to be done up so tight they can't be moved. Make sure everything is done up to a firm feel. One of the most important things to do when you use your new telescope, when you observe, keep both eyes open. It really is important, because if you do this, if you squint, electrical impulses leak over to the other eye and makes the eyeball vibrate. The eyeball vibrates, it actually suppresses signal going to the brain, so you actually see less, and you'll be much more comfortable at the eyepiece. Keep both eyes open. Now, although this telescope mount and tripod are a fairly typical example of an entry-level instrument, then it's not exceptional in terms of its lightness. And it suffers from a thing we call in the trade toffee apple syndrome, which is a tendency for the instrument to have all of its weight puckered at the top and virtually nothing lower down. So one of the things you can do to improve the stability of the system is take a carrier bag like this and add some weight to the tripod. Simply attach that to a wire underneath your telescope. Now all of a sudden, the telescope now is really quite substantial. We've added a lot of weight low down, so the center of gravity has gone down and the telescope now is a lot more stable. It just physically feels more substantial and it'll be far freer from vibration and wind and that kind of thing. To be sure of getting the best views with your instrument, no matter how small it is, give it a chance to acclimatize to the outside air temperature. It's likely that when you put your telescope out, it's going to be significantly warmer than the air temperature outside, in which case the instrument's going to be radiating heat. This is actually going to disturb the views that you actually get with the instrument. So if you've got anything up to about a 4-inch telescope, give it at least 20 minutes, just enough time to get your eyepieces and put your coat on and sort yourself out before making your observations. Over 4 inches, probably give it at least another 10 minutes per inch of aperture before you actually make your first crucial observations. A good day for solar observing, so here are a few tips to get you going. Absolutely the first tip to bring to your attention is safety. When you're going to be observing the sun, safety is very much your responsibility. Make sure everyone else who's observing the sun with you knows how dangerous it can be pointing any kind of optical aid towards the sun. Be particularly careful with children. There's a really good chance that they're going to be trusting you and looking through the telescope. There's a real risk that they're going to go away, go back to their own homes and maybe avail themselves of an optical instrument. Make sure their parents know what you're doing and that it's not safe to let children alone during the day with an optical aid after you've been looking at the sun. Read almost any book written probably a decade or two ago and you're going to see constant references to observing the sun using the eyepiece projection method. This is a simple idea where you don't put any kind of filters on the telescope at all and you simply orientate the eyepiece conveniently when you're viewing the sun and project the image of the sun onto the screen. If you are going to use that method, you need to make absolutely sure that all of the parts of your telescope are made of metal and you don't have any decorative finishes that are going to be damaged. If you leave the telescope for any length of time observing the sun using the projection method, there's a good chance that the image of the sun, so the hot part, the hot spot of the sun, is going to drift into the focus or even the side of the telescope tube. It's going to get very hot and it's going to do damage. With today's modern telescopes that use a lot of ABS plastic in the design both of the eyepiece and other fittings, there's a real chance you're going to destroy some part of your telescope. The only type of solar filter I can really recommend is this type of full aperture solar filter that fits on the end here. Collimation. I know you're not going to like this one, but if you've got a new Newtonian reflector, it really is a good idea to get involved with the collimation of it as soon as you possibly can. Actually, look at your instructions. There's plenty of help on the internet. We've got videos on our YouTube channel as well. But do remember, 30, maybe even 40% of the performance of the telescope can be tied up in making sure the instrument's got good collimation. Deal with it and as soon as you can. Focusing your instrument can be harder than you expected. It's all very well when the seeing conditions, that's the quality of the atmosphere, is good. You can get a nice sharp image of a planet or of a star or of a lunar crater. But when the seeing conditions are poor, it can be very difficult to tell whether you're getting an improved image in the eyepiece, whether it's a little bit blurry, whether it's a bit less blurry. The eye is actually not very good at determining that. Every time you make an adjustment of the telescope and touch it to check the focus, you introduce vibration, you've got to wait for that to settle out. Combining that with less than ideal seeing conditions can make it actually quite frustrating. Now, there are gadgets on the market that you can buy, a thing called a focus mask. This is one made by Astro Engineering. This one has three holes in it. Now the idea is, obviously this is made for a much bigger telescope, you stick this device over the front cell of your instrument and it will turn everything you're looking at into two images instead of one. Now this works to achieve the focus because the human eye is much better at looking at moving things and judging distances than it is in being able to tell the difference between something that's fuzzy and something that's a little bit less fuzzy or a bit more fuzzy. Take a look at this. You're going to need a piece of cardboard. First, just find something that's comfortably about a centimeter bigger than the size of your front cell. In this case, I'm using another dust cap, but you could use a dinner plate or goodness knows, you could even use a compass, couldn't you? So put that down on the cardboard, just make a rough mark around it. Quickly cut that out. With a refractor, you could just make a judgment, but in this case, I'm just finding something that fits conveniently in between the secondary and the gap in the tube wall, and I'm going to use that to create my mask holes. It will help just to know where the original, so I'm just going to draw around the original cap again, and I'm just going to position these pretty close to the edge of the cell. Next thing is to simply make a couple of holes around about 120 degrees apart. You could just put a couple of nails through. I've got a couple of plastic screws here that I'm going to put through, just to put so it can be held on. And that's it, we're ready to go. So equipped with our piece of cardboard, all we've got to do now is point the instrument at a planet, star, lunar crater, whatever we're looking at. Pop it over the front of the instrument. Look in the eyepiece. When it's out of focus, you're going to see two images. When you get it bang on focus, you're going to have just a single image to view. When you're ready to observe, remember to take the mask off. Well, here's a very simple tip to enable you to find the sun. I know that sounds a bit silly, finding the sun, but don't forget, telescope's got a very narrow field of view, so you're still going to need a little bit of help. And rather than using finders or anything like that, why not just use the simple physics of the shadow of the telescope? Simply steer the telescope so that we get the smallest possible profile of the telescope, and we can now see that the telescope's pointing pretty well at the sun. So you can usually use the shadow of the instrument to actually line the telescope up, and you can see quite easily that that's off, and that's on. Your finder, probably one of the best ways of treating that is probably to remove it from the telescope, or at the very least cap it. Even if you've got a red dot finder on the telescope, get that capped or remove it from the instrument. Do bear in mind, if you expose the crosshairs in a finder like this, they're probably made of nylon monofilament, the image of the sun is going to burn them in a fraction of a second and they'll be gone. And you certainly don't want to emulate the behaviour of one of our viewers who actually managed to set fire to his beard. Got a telescope more than about 75 millimeters in diameter, that's about 3 inches, you'll probably benefit from a moon filter. This will actually cut down the glare that we get from the moon. Don't forget, we observe the moon in full daylight. This is like wearing dark glasses, putting dark glasses on your telescope. It'll cut down the amount of glare, and believe it or not, the eye will be able to fasten on fine details a little bit better with a moon filter. Have a look at this one. This is a blue filter. This one's an 80A. You can get an 82. There's a number of different colors, but a blue filter like this one, it's pretty much the Swiss Army knife of filters. You can use this for almost anything. It'll work as a moon filter, you can split binaries with it, you can use it to observe Jupiter and heighten some of the cloud belt details, you can use it on Saturn, and you can use it on other planets as well. So if you're going to buy just one filter, make it a bluey. Now obviously your eyepieces, if they're good ones, will be equipped with a filter thread at the front here, and that's obviously where the manufacturers intend you to fit the filter. But in actual fact, if you're an old hand at observing, you may find you get all the benefits you need from using the filter simply by dropping it into the eye cup like that. It makes it a lot easier to use. Another way of using it is to see if your diagonal, if you're using a refracting telescope, has got a filter thread on the front of the diagonal. That way you can change your eyepieces and have the filter in line without having to change it. If you're trying to make observations in the deep sky and are finding it very difficult to find the target, you're fishing around and you actually can't see anything, instead of increasing the field of view by going with a wide field eyepiece, which might be your inclination and you can be forgiven for thinking it would be a good idea, do the complete opposite. Go with a higher power eyepiece. So if you're using a 15 like I've got in here, go with a 10. If you're using a 20, go with a 15. If you're using a 26, go with a 20. Increase the power, narrow the field of view, it'll make the background darker, and the deep sky fuzzy is more likely to pop out of the background so that you can see it. Eyepiece trays, they're a great idea, of course, to be able to put all your bits and pieces and keep it nearby and on hand at the telescope, but they don't protect your eyepieces from dewing, and they also allow them to cool down a little bit too rapidly as well. Maybe put them in a plastic lunchbox or something like that to keep the dew off, or even just cap them very simply like that with any caps that you've got available. That way they'll preserve a little bit of their heat, they'll be less likely to steam up when you put them on your face, and dew won't settle on them either. Unfortunately, the clouds have moved in and the wind's got up, so we've had to retire indoors. So you're gonna have to use your imagination a little bit. We're looking at the sun. We've got our solar filter perched on the top here. But straight away, there's a bit of a problem because we're out in bright light. The area around the eyepiece is gonna be very brightly illuminated. Why not create a bit of local shadow with a nice little device like this that goes around the front of the cell of your telescope tube. It's designed to be adjustable. It does up at the back here. It's a nice little gadget, and it'll help make me richer because it was actually designed by me, so I'm bound to recommend it. But in all fairness, you can make something like this out of a bit of a cardboard. Just watch this. It simply goes over the front here. Remember to put your solar filter back on. It's going to create a little miniature environment in the area of the eyepiece so that wherever you point the telescope, you're actually going to be nice and in the shade back here at the eyepiece. It'll improve the contrast of your views and you'll be able to observe the sun in a great deal more comfort. There are certain things that the human eye does that you can really exploit at the eyepiece of the telescope. One of them is the eye's ability to detect movement and motion. It's extremely sensitive to this. So if you're trying to find a faint fuzzy in a fairly dark sky, try moving the telescope slightly while you're looking through it. You only need to rock it very gently. What you may see then is that the faint diffuse nebula that you're trying to assess the size and how far it penetrates into the sky suddenly seems to pop out. You can also get that movement by rocking the slow motion on your mount as well. One of the most important techniques to exploit the sensitivity of the retina of your eye when you're trying to make observations in the deep sky is to use what's called the averted vision technique. Keep looking at me, keep your eye on the center of the screen, but take an interest in the things that are outside of the screen. In fact, the further you can go, the better. The further you can go from what you're looking at on the screen. Don't take your eyes off me, keep your eye on the screen, but try to take an interest in things that are going on off the screen around it. It's a bit like reading a line of text, but trying to take an interest in the text that's three or four lines below, three or four lines above, or several words on either side of the word you're reading. That's averted vision. There's a bit of an art to it. Try it out next time you're using the telescope. Keep an observing log. You'll be surprised at how just writing down your observations, these are sheets you can download from the internet. You only need an old diary, something like this. Write down a very brief diary note about your observation. You'll be surprised at how the business of thinking about what you saw and writing it down will actually sharpen your observation powers. And that's about it for this video. If you wanted to see any of those points in a bit more detail, be sure to visit our channel. We've covered most of those points in really quite thorough detail, I think. If you want to stay up with our latest videos, don't forget to subscribe. You can also follow us on our Facebook page now as well. That'll help keep you up to date. And it wouldn't do any harm if you gave us a like on there as well. Anyway, clear skies to all. I look forward to seeing you soon. Bye now.